being here, Pastor Yardley Griffin Jr. Let's welcome him as he comes.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Can you do me a favor? Can you leave your seat and go shake somebody's hand and say, good to see you? Can you leave your seat, go shake somebody's hand and say, good to see you? Come on and bless the Lord with me. Bless the Lord with me. Come on and bless the Lord with me. Bless the Lord with me. Y'all can help me. Say, bless the Lord, say. Come on and bless the Lord with me.
Bless the Lord with me.
Come on and bless the Lord with me, yeah.
Bless the Lord with me.
Come on and bless the Lord with me, yeah. Come on, put your hands on it. Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Say hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Say hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Say hallelujah, yeah. Come on, put your hands together. Come on, one time, everybody right here. Come on. Everybody clapping. Everybody clapping. Everybody clapping. Come on. Everybody clapping. Everybody clapping. Come on, everybody. Come on. Now while you clap, you got to smile, okay? Put a smile on your face. Don't be mad. Now tell your neighbor, say, bless the Lord with me. Say, bless
the Lord with me.
Come on, tell your neighbor, say, bless the Lord with me. Yes.
The Lord with me.
Say, bless the Lord with me. Yeah. Say, bless the Lord with me.
Bless the Lord with me.
Say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Say, hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Say, hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Now clap your hands. Everybody clapping. Everybody clapping. Say, clap your hands with me. Come on, tell your neighbor. Tell them, say it. Clap. Come on, tell your neighbor, say, clap your hands with me, yeah.
Clap your hands with me.
Say, clap your hands with me, yeah.
Clap your hands with me.
Say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Come on, keep clapping. Keep clapping, keep clapping, keep clapping. Come on and praise the Lord with me. Tell your neighbor, say, praise the Lord. Say, praise
the Lord with me.
Tell your neighbor, say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord with me.
Say, praise the Lord with me, yeah.
Praise the Lord with me.
Say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah. Y'all not clapping and smiling. Come on, put your hands on it real fast. God, we give your name honor and we give your name praise, oh God. We lift you up, God, today in this place. Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Say hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
One more time. Everybody put your hands on it. Come on. Oh, you not clapping like you mean it. Come on, clap your hands, everybody. Say hallelujah, yeah. shout out hallelujah. Would you give him a shout of hallelujah, everybody? Hallelujah. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Y'all know it, right? Y'all know it, right? Come on, throw your hands up, everybody. Hands up, hands up. And I will bless
the Lord.
Oh, my soul.
Oh, my soul.
And all that is within me. Holy name. Say it one more time. Put your hands up, everybody. Just right there in your seat. Come on, do it, please. And I will
bless the Lord.
Oh, my soul.
Oh, my soul.
And I'll say
and all
that is. Somebody ought to
bless his
holy, his holy name. Would you grab somebody by the hand? Grab on everybody by the hand. Look at him in the face. Grab him by the hand. Grab him. Come look at him. Look at him. Tell him, for he has done. Come on, grab it. Testify to him. Testify to him. He has done great things. This is my testimony. He brought me out. He gave me another chance. He saved me. He delivered me. He healed me. He has done great things, saint. Come on, say it one more time. Grab another neighbor. Grab somebody behind you or in front of you. Come on, look at him. Grab him. Tell him, for he has done great things. Tell him, come on, help me. I'll say, for he has
done great things.
Come on, look at him. Testify. That's my testimony. He has done great things. You don't know like I know what God did for me. You weren't there when he brought me out. That's why I shout, oh.
Bless him. Bless his holy.
One more time. And I will say it.
Bless the Lord.
Can I teach him one song, Pastor? Teach him one song? All right, I'm going to teach you a song, okay? I got a little record. It's called Hear Me Now. Tell your neighbor, say, God is good.
God is good.
Say, God is good.
God is good.
Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor.
Let's learn this song.
Now, everybody look up to heaven. Say, you are good.
You are good.
Lord, you are good.
Lord,
is God good, everybody?
Yeah.
Is God good, everybody?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Brian. Is God good, everybody?
Yeah.
I'm going to teach you a real simple song, okay? It's real easy. It just says, you are good. Good Lord, you are good. Okay? It's real easy. Oh, you know what? You're going to back me up? You bought the CD. You should know, buddy. It's real easy, okay? It's real simple, okay? It's real simple. It says, you alone are worthy of honor and praise.
You are worthy of honor and praise.
Master of heaven, creation,
Master
and man. You know it. Lord of all,
the angels still bow.
It's real simple. It says we worship. It says we worship. It says we worship. Oh Lord, we worship.
Oh Lord, we worship.
Oh, some of y'all know it. I appreciate that. Some of y'all know it. You know. Watch this.
You alone are worthy of honor and praise, Master of heaven, creation, and man. Lord of all the angels, still bow down and say, we worship, we worship, we worship. Oh Lord, we worship you.
This your party says you are good, good. Watch this.
You are good, good. Lord, you are good, good, good. Lord, you are good, good, good. Lord, you got it. Say we worship. Say we worship. Say we worship. Oh Lord.
Oh Lord, we worship.
That's all I need to know. Can you clap your hands if you worship God today, everybody?
Lord of the harvest and master of truth, redeemer of man, he's the God of breakthrough. And honor and glory, it belongs to you. And I worship, I worship, I worship. Oh Lord, I worship you.
Then they'll say it. Watch.
Lord of the harvest and master of truth, redeemer of man, he's the God of breakthrough. Honor and glory be unto you.
And I worship.
I worship.
I worship.
I worship.
I worship.
I worship.
Oh Lord, I worship you.
Oh Lord, I worship.
Mr. Potter, if I could join in and say, say you are good, say it. Say you are good. The Lord is so
good.
Say we worship. Say we worship. Say we worship.
Oh Lord.
You got it now. Come on, say it again.
Say the Lord is so good. Say. The Lord is so good. My God is so good. Say we worship, say we worship, say we worship, oh Lord.
You got it now, come on, join me everybody. Come on, join me y'all. Say the Lord is good. The Lord is so good. You got it.
My God is so good. Say we worship, we worship, we worship, oh Lord.
You get one more time. Can you stand with me and say, say the Lord is.
Oh!
The Lord is so good. Now everybody can join. Say we worship.
We worship.
Say we worship. Come on.
We
say we worship.
We worship.
Say we worship.
We worship.
They that worship,
we worship,
they must bow down.
We
they that worship,
we worship,
they should lift their hands.
We
say we worship.
We worship.
Say we worship.
We worship.
Where are my worshipers?
We
worship. Where are my praises?
We worship.
Where are my shouters?
We worship.
Where are my screamers?
We worship.
Where are my ones who love the Lord?
We
say we praise you.
We
praise you. Where my praises at? Where my praises at? You don't mind blessing him. You don't mind magnifying him. You don't mind lifting him. You don't mind giving him glory. Come on. Say we love you.
We
love you.
We
love you.
We
love you.
We
love you.
We
love you.
We
say we worship.
We
praise you.
We
worship,
we
praise,
we
worship,
we
praise,
we
worship,
we
praise. You alone are worthy of honor and praise, Master of heaven, creation and man, Lord of all the angels, still bow down and say, we worship,
we
worship, we worship. Oh Lord, we worship. You are good, good Lord, you are good. Good, good Lord. We worship,
we
worship, we worship, we worship, we worship, we worship, we worship. Hey, we, oh God, we worship. Lord, you've been so good to me, we worship. Hallelujah. Would you give God a big praise, everybody? Give him a big old praise. Thank you all so much for letting me come. Thank you.
How many of you know that the Lord is good? How many of you know that the Lord is good? The Bible says the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting. His truth to all generations. Hallelujah. Amen. We thank God for Bishop, for Pastor Griffin coming, reminding us that God is good. In spite of what we're going through, he's good. In spite of what we're going through, he's good. I said, in spite of what it is that we're experiencing, God is still good. So whatever you're going through, please remember that God is good. I said, God is good. God is good. I said, God is good. God is good. We thank God for Pastor Yardley Griffin for coming over and sharing with us. Amen. Thank God for him. Hallelujah. 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 Bless his holy name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah. Bless God. Bless his holy name. Bless his name. Also, at the close of service, I'm going to announce it right now that Pastor Griffin, he does have a project out, and we're going to ask everyone if you'd like to support his project, the CD project. amen, that we will go ahead and support them. They'll be available after service on the day. Those of you who would like to, you can do that. And it will be a great investment to add to your music collection. Put it in your CD player as you drive at home, just chilling. And we need to go ahead and support. He's one of our own. He's one of our own. He's my brother in the ministry. And amen. And we sing together also in a group called Pastors United. And so I would invite us to make sure that we support that project. To God be the praise. Let's give God another hand of praise right now. I need to do this as quickly as I can because we have some other guests who are here and they need to make a presentation that is very, very important, and it's going to kind of shift what we're doing right now, but we need to do it because they do have to go someplace else. But we want to hear and pay attention because it can be something that can help some members of this church. And then after that, we're going to get back into it because we still got to hear the word of God. Somebody say amen. Amen. Come on.
Thank you, Pastor. My name is Larry Courtney. I'm out of the Bay Area. Today we have Les with us, and we've got Fred with us. We've got John with us. What we do is insurance, last expense plans for churches. That's all we work with. We're into over 200 churches in the Bay Area right now, and we're picking up literally a church a week. So it's really, really growing. I'd like to make one comment on your members. We're, like I said, a lot of churches. But if you can't feel the Spirit in here this morning, I'm going to say you get down tomorrow morning, first thing, get a checkup, because you're dead. Okay, we have what we call information for life. And what we're finding is that many of the churches, when one passes away, the family or members are coming to the church for financial help. The churches don't have it today. The money's just not there. The other thing is that we're finding many people are not planning. Now, some of you may have some insurance and think you're all taken care of, and that's good. Not quite. You're only 50% there. Because you see, if you don't plan it, write it down, it will not be done according to your wishes. It's no different than taking a trip here and going to go to the East Coast. You just don't jump in your car and take a ride. You're going to plan. This is one trip we're all going to take, and we better plan it. Because if you don't, it's not going to be done the way you want. Now, also, the boys or the guys here will be passing around a clipboard. If you're interested in talking with us, just put your name, address, phone number on there. We'll give you a call. Best time to call. If you have a plan already, maybe even with another company, we don't care. We'll take a look at it for you and explain what it is you may have. We're finding many, many people have plans and they have no idea what it is, what they have in the way of coverage. So your church, as I mentioned, doesn't have the money. Most of the times, the families don't have the money. Now, if a family does have $15,000, $20,000 stashed away in the bank, then you probably don't need our services. But most of us don't have that kind of money. And our friends, it's not up to them. We have to take care of it ourselves. Now, if you don't plan it, you can bet the funeral home's going to plan it for you. And when they do that, it's going to get a little costly. So if you have a $10,000 plan, that funeral is probably going to come to $15,000. If it's you have $15,000, it'll probably come to $20,000. You always have a tendency to spend more because that's the last thing you can do for somebody. A lot of emotion involved, and they're going to spend. So you need to write it down. Social Security. You can go ahead and start passing around if you wish, and because we have to get to another church right after here or so. Anyway, Social Security only pays $255. Many people think that's going to cover it all, and it doesn't. And you better be married at the time. And if your spouse has passed away and got the 255, when you pass away, you don't get another 255. There's only one. So you don't count on it. Now, you're being bombarded on TV with all kinds of these companies. You've got MetLife, you've got ARP, you've got Globe Life. So who do you believe? Well, I have to admit, it's tough. It's really hard. Globe Life just sent one out, and they insure you until age 90. What happens if you live to age 91? You have no coverage. It's all gone. ARP's plan goes until age 80, and then it's gone. I used to think they were for us seniors, but I don't think so. So you have to really be careful. On Globe Life, they just sent out a new piece of advertising. I got it in the mail, and it was interesting, because I'm always looking to see if they can increase your premiums. Big bold print, it said, can we increase your premiums? No. We cannot increase your premiums due to change in health or change in occupation. Well, that's a joke, because that's the law. They're not giving you anything. But what you're reading is, it's really marketing. What you're hearing and seeing is they can't raise your premiums. You forget that it's due to health or occupation change. So again, you really got to be careful. It's hard. Okay. Well, sometimes this thing gets a little mind of its own. Any veterans in here? One veteran. You know, I'll skip in the essence of time, I'm going to skip some of the veterans stuff. If it's a non-service related death, you only get $300. And if it's in a VA hospital, you get $700. That's it. That's all. We don't take care of our vets at all. Also, well, if it's a non-service related death, you get a free plot in the National Cemetery. That's the good news. The bad news is you got to get there. That's at your expense or the family's expense. Or if you go to a private cemetery, they'll give you a $700 plot allowance and not much else. So as I said before, we don't take care of our veterans. Cost of the average funeral today will run $8,000, and as you can see, that doesn't cover much. Funeral costs can hit $10,000 very easy without doing much of anything. I talked to a gentleman about 2 months ago, and he was telling me they spent $32,000 on funeral. I said, how in the world do you spend $32,000 on a funeral? He said, well, we had 8 limousines. I said, don't those people have cars? I mean, come on. Again, nothing written down, no plans made. Luella Ryder's a little lady. She's about 80-some years old now over in Oakland. And she came up to me after one of my presentations and said, would I come out and take a look at her policies, which I did. She already had her plot paid for. So this is what I found when we got there. She had $39,000 of coverage, paying $409 a month. She said, I can't pay my bills. I said, I can see why. If you look at the years up there, they're not in order, but you can see where somebody was coming out every year and selling this lady another policy, which she didn't need. That, to me, is the worst sin I think you can do, especially to a senior who's trying to get along on a fixed income. So when I got finished, this is what she has now. $12,000 of coverage. She's paying $75 a month. That's it. People ask me, what did you sell her? Didn't sell her anything. She didn't need anything, but I get something better than that every time I see her. I get a big hug, and she calls me her boy. You can't beat that. Oh, she also got down in front of the congregation and showed them 3 checks. We found some hidden money, checks worth a little over $1,500. Now, our plans cover up to $35,000. Do you need $35,000 for a funeral or a plot? No, absolutely not. But some of the grandparents like to leave money to the grandkids for education or whatever the case might be. Travel protection, you take it with you no matter where you go in the world, provides peace of mind to your family and takes the burden off of your church. These are permanent policies. These are not term. And I'll explain the difference to you real fast here. Permanent is one that you have for life. You have it forever. premiums don't go up, the insurance doesn't go down, you have it forever. Term means just what it says. It goes for a term of time. And then it runs out, or those premiums will go through the roof. You will not be able to afford to keep them. Now, you'll see some of these on TV. It says term to age 92, and that's true. What they don't show you on the screen is what the cost is. They can't, because there's no way on earth could you afford it. So again, gotta be careful. Okay, 2 minutes. We range from $2,500 to $35,000. We can fit any budget. Your premiums never go up. Benefits never go down. Bills to cash value. We pay directly to your beneficiary, so it all comes in tax-free. Now, you may have group life. You may have employer union-sponsored plans, and these are excellent as long as you're employed. When you retire or quit, they're generally gone. We can take anybody, no matter what your health is, as long as you're not in the hospital right now, and somebody, if the doctor hasn't said you're going to pass away in the next 6 months, we have a plan. We can write you, and I don't think anybody else can make that statement. We can also leave a tax-free donation to your church. If you had $1,000 and would love to leave it to your church, how are you going to do that? Most of us don't have that kind of money. We can show you how you can do this, and it won't cost you one penny more. When you have a plan, you can have money included in there to come into your church when you pass away. It's called a future endowment. And I'm sure if that were to happen, pastor would put up a nice little plaque with your name on it. How nice it would be to have the grandkids come in and say, "That's grandma's up there. She did that for the church." We can show you how you can do that. It doesn't cost you any more money. Okay, what can we do for you? For every policy that's issued, we donate $10 into your church. We set up the future endowments for you. That's when you pass away. Money comes into the church. Takes the burden off the church. We work within your budget. We have worldwide coverage. How am I doing time-wise? I think I'm okay. I should have about 30 seconds to go. Yeah, the pastor's trying to cut me off here. Okay. When I drove up, I noticed there's a little bit of a parking problem out front here. I've got that solved. We run into this with a lot of the churches. So I came up with this. If pastor will put this sign out front, nobody will park in front of this church. Guaranteed. And here it is. Church parking only. Violators will be baptized. That'll clear them out. Thank you for having us here today. We'll be in contact with you. Thanks for your time. Thank you, Pastor.
Let me share with this. These gentlemen have made presentations at our state convention in our district, and the information I believe is helpful because I'm tired of driving around and seeing people having car washes, having to bury their loved ones, and I do not want that to be the plight of the members of Mount Calvary Missionary Baptist Church. So we ask that you would please put your name on the clipboard or get their cards. You contact them. They have no affiliation. I don't get no kicks or nothing. The thing that I get is that the members of Mount Calvary who may not have coverage will possibly get coverage, and that is a blessing to me. And so we want to thank God. Why don't you give God a hand of praise for them and thank God for them coming and making their presentation. Amen. To God be the praise. If anybody wants to give you a name, I said, just wave your hand. They'll give you the clipboard, and we will move forward. Somebody ought to say amen. 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 Now, Pastor Griffin said do it again, but I want you to do it and shake your hands with your neighbor and just say, "I'm glad I came today. I'm glad I came today. I'm glad I came today." Good to see you, man. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Can I ask you a question? Okay, come on, let's come on back, come on back, come on back, come on back this way. Okay, come on back this way, come on back this way. Come on back this way. I need y'all to come on back this way. No. I need y'all to come on back this way. Come on back this way. Come on back this way. When Pastor Yardley Griffin was singing, that last song he sang was "Lord, good, good, Lord, you are good. Good, good, Lord, you are good." Can I ask you a question? Was God good to you this past week? I'm just asking. I don't know. I don't know what you've experienced. I don't know what you've been through. But it is a master's God. Something good happened sometime this morning or last night because you're here right now. Amen. And I know I'm going to heaven, and I'm not going to be like everybody. I can't wait to go. I'm waiting. I want to wait a long time. And I know I read in the Bible what it's going to be about like when I get there. But there's some stuff that I'm experiencing here, and just to have the presence of the Lord with me. Amen. It's just a blessing. It's just a blessing. Come on, you ought to thank God right now. I said you ought to thank God right now because he's good. Has anyone experienced his goodness lately? I mean, really? Have you experienced his goodness? Have you really experienced his goodness? Come on, give God a big hand of praise now. Come on, y'all. No, you act like you're clapping for me. I said give God a big hand of praise because he is good. He is great. He is greatly to be praised. I said he is greatly to be praised. Todd, you ought to be clapping your hands a whole lot right now, man. I'm serious. God has been good to you. He has been good to us. Good to us. He has been good to us, and we bless his name on today. Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. How many of you know that you can't live without the Lord? That you'd be lost without him, that you'd be nothing without him. Somebody just lift your hand and say, I'm nothing without you. Just lift your hand and say, I'm nothing without you. I'm nothing without you, God. I'd be lost like a ship without a sail. I'm nothing without you, God. Hallelujah. Song says,
in him do I live, move, and have my being. Oh. Do I live, move, and have my being? Yes. 'Cause I'm nothing without you. God, I'm nothing without you. Lord, I'm nothing without you. God, I'm nothing without you.
Help me say.
In him do I live, move, and have my being.
In him do I live, move, and have my being.
In him do I live, move, and have my being. Cause I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
Cause I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
God, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
Say I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
God, I'm nothing without you.
And let your glory reign.
you.
I'm nothing without you.
Say, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
God, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
God, I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
Say, I'm nothing without you. Lift your hand and say, I'm nothing without you. Say, I'm nothing without you. Say, I can't live without you.
I can't live without you.
God, I'm nothing without you. I'm nothing without you.
I'm nothing without you.
Somebody lift your hands. Cause you'll be lost without us. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody say 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 hallelujah. Say, I'm nothing without you, Jesus.
How many of you know that you're nothing without the Lord?
think if they were singing it in the old way, they'd say, I need the old. I need thee.
The question, do you really need him? Do you really need him? You're not a self-made man. You really need him. You're not your own. You need him. As strong as you may be, as much money as you think you might have, you still need him. You need him. I know I need him. I can't make it without him. He promised he'd never leave me. Promised he'd never forsake me. Oh, I need him today. Oh, I need him today. Oh, my God, I need him today. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I may not make it to tomorrow, but I need him right now. Bless his holy name. Say, bless his holy name. Bless his holy name. Bless his holy name. Can I ask you something? Has God been there for you? I'm just asking. I don't know. I don't know what your experience is, but I know he's been there for me. And when I know he's been there for me, I gotta help him tell him thank you. Yeah, why y'all looking at me like that? I'm not me. I'm talking about the Lord. Has he been there for you? Has he protected you? Has he kept you? Has he kept you? Did he forgive you? Did he forgive you? I said, did he forgive you? I guess some of y'all ain't did nothing wrong in a long time, but some of us know he forgave us. And I don't know about you, I thank God every day. I thank God every day. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. CJ, see if you can catch me real quick. What key is this? What key is that? Yeah, that's it right there. Yeah, that one right there. No, go down one. No, go back up. Okay, yeah, that's it. Okay, I don't know if you know this, but it's a little churchy song. Could have been the other way. It could have been the other way. The Lord woke me this morning with the touch of his love. It could have been the other way. Oh, it could have been the other way. It could have been the other way. The Lord woke me this morning with the touch of his love. It could have been the other way. Oh, it could have been the other way. It could have been the other way. The Lord woke me this morning with the touch of his love. It could have been the other way. Well, you can visit the sick and the shut in.
stop by the hospital to ask the patient how they're doing, and this is what I believe they say to you. Well, I could have been dead, sleeping in my grave, but oh Lord, you made death behave, and I thank you, Lord. It could have been the other way, oh, it could have been the other way. It could have been the other way. The Lord woke me this morning with the touch of his love. It could have been the other way. One more time, it could have been the other way. It could have been the other way. The Lord woke me this morning with the touch of his love. The Lord woke me this morning with the touch of his love. Did he wake you this morning with the touch of his love? The Lord woke me this morning with the touch of his love. The Lord woke me this morning with the touch of his love. He woke me this morning with the touch of his love. The Lord woke me this morning with the touch of his love. It could have been the other way. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. Bless his holy name. I'm glad to be here, and I thank God for just being here. And we've had all kind of guests today, but I thank God for the gentleman who's going to stand to proclaim the word of God on today. Met him a couple of months ago at a revival service, and we just hit it off. And he's just shown himself to be a brother beloved. He pastors the Emmaus Road Baptist Church, College Park, Georgia, which is not far from Atlanta, I do believe. And he's here, and I thank God for him coming and consenting to be our preacher for this morning. Let's say amen and thank God for Dr. Sedrick Hamner as he comes today.
Well, that was great for me. I wish you'd put your hands together and give God some praise. I see y'all insist on clapping for me. I said, put your hands together and give the Lord some praise. Come on, somebody knows, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the name of the Lord is worthy to be praised. Have I got a witness in here? I wish I had a witness over in here somewhere. Amen. Y'all feel like having a little church? I said, y'all feel like having a little church? Will you just tap your neighbor real soft and ask him, neighbor, are you breathing? Ask him, are you breathing? Are you breathing? Get an answer back. Get an answer back. Hallelujah. Well, tell him, let everything that have breath praise the Lord. Y'all are still acting kind of docile and dead. Let me give you five reasons why you ought to praise the Lord. Reason number one, he woke you up this morning. Reason number two, he woke you up this morning. Reason number three, he woke you up this morning. Somebody go catch it in a minute. Reason number four, he woke you up this morning. And reason number five, he woke you up this morning. And so if you got breath in your body, I said if you got breath in your body, let everything that have breath praise the Lord. Come on and give him praise in the building. He's worthy. Oh, he's worthy. Hallelujah. Come on, clap your hands, will you, real good one more time. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. I don't know about you, but it's good to be in church, isn't it? I said it's good to be in church. Amen. Hallelujah. Will you salute this man of God, the one that keeps watch for your soul? He's the angel of this house. Amen. He's an electric, amen, anointed and appointed blessed man of God. He's a great friend of mine. I want y'all to give God praise for my friend. Amen. Your pastor, Dr. Brian Wyatt. Your enthusiasm is overwhelming me. I said, give God praise for your man of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. We celebrate him. Hallelujah. Amen. And certainly we celebrate Lady Wyatt today. Amen. I was here a couple months ago preaching for the district-wide revival. And I'm just going to tell the truth. They had me out on a limb. Amen. But your pastor, because he's a God man, amen, and believes the Bible. And the Bible says that if you're going to have a friend, you got to show yourself friendly. Amen. And it also says that you got to be careful about how you entertain strangers, because you might be entertaining an angel and not know it. I wish I had two Bible readers. Amen. And so he thought it not robbery, because he is who he is and has the anointing of God on his life. Showed me, amen, a good dosage of what we call, where I'm from, Southern hospitality. Amen. Very kind to me. And for his kindness, I am eternally grateful. I said it then, I'll say it again. My mama taught me that people don't have to be nice. And when people are being nice, they don't have to be nice to you. She said the right thing to do is when you come across some people who happen to be nice and they happen to be being nice to you, that the right thing to do is to tell them thank you. Amen. And so I'm here to say thank you and let you know what kind of man of God you really have. I said, and let you know what kind of man of God you really have. Ain't nobody happy. Amen. Now, listen, you can get preachers a dime a dozen. I said, you can get preachers a dime a dozen. Amen. You can get a preacher a dime a dozen. It ain't hard to get a preacher. Amen. But it's difficult, hallelujah, to have a man of God in the midst of your life. And you ought to thank God that your pastor is a true man of God. Y'all ain't catching it. Hallelujah. Let me try it like this. Ephesians 4 and 11 says, and he gave some pastors. Amen. Teachers, evangelists, pastor, teachers, apostles. Amen. Hallelujah. It said, and he gave some apostles, prophets, hallelujah, evangelists, pastor, teachers, and he gave. Let me try it again. And he gave. Hallelujah. And he gave. Hallelujah. So you know this because you know how you feel at Christmas time. Anything given is a gift. I wish somebody would catch what I'm saying. Amen. So don't you ever discount the fact that your pastor, amen, is a man of God, and he is a gift from God to you. Your enthusiasm overwhelms me. He's a gift from God, amen, to you. And you know how you feel when you give your nappy-head children gifts at Christmas? Amen. You know how it goes. You know, my kids are grown now, but you know, they used to buy them gifts, they play with them for 2 weeks, and then they go back to the old stuff. Have I got a witness in here? You know how you feel, right? You done worked hard for your money. Amen, amen. And you said what I said. If I'd have known they were only going to play with it for 2 weeks, I'd have kept the receipt. Have I got a witness? Amen. Took it back and got my money. And some of y'all declared that you would do that. Amen. If they don't leave the old stuff alone and start playing with the new stuff. Do I have a witness here? Amen. And so when you got a man of God and you know that he's a gift from God, what I'm trying to tell you is that you need to value and appreciate the gift that you have. I say you need to value and appreciate the gift that you have while you got it. Amen. Because here's the truth. The truth is this. I tell my church this all the time. Hallelujah. The truth is that another church, they always want somebody else's pastor. That's what they want somebody else's pastor. I wish I had help, amen. So ministers, you know, y'all know, it's hard to get a church when you ain't a pastor. Amen. You're just an associate minister. It's tough to get called to a church. Amen. But when you got a church, you know, it's easy. Because they figure if he can pastor over there, maybe he can pastor us. Amen. And do better. So I just want you to know that you got a great man of God. Amen. And Pastor Brian Wyatt. Y'all gonna make it hard, I can tell. Amen. I said, you got a great man of God. I forgot to. I normally say this when I'm a little further in the sermon, but I might as well say it now. I'm grown and I ain't scared of none of y'all. Amen. I said, you got a great man of God. Hallelujah. Boy, y'all making it hard. All right. Praise the Lord. I'm happy to be here at the invitation of your pastor. And thank God for my son, CJ, on the organ. Amen. I think y'all know him pretty good. Amen. Hallelujah. So here it is. I want to preach from Mark chapter number 9. Mark chapter 9. Amen. Same God in Atlanta is the same God in Sacramento. I'm happy to be here and to meet y'all in particular. Amen. I'm not new to SAC. I'm new to you. Hallelujah. Amen. Mark chapter number 9. I'm going to preach a few minutes and get out your way. You got Mark 9? Hallelujah. Verse 14. I'm reading from the English Standard Version. It says, and when they came to the disciples, they saw great crowd around them and the scribes arguing with them, and immediately all of the crowd, when they saw him, they were greatly amazed, and they ran up to him and greeted him. Verse 16 says, and he asked them, them being the disciples, he says, what are you arguing with them about? And someone from the crowd said, teacher, master, I brought to you my son, and he has a spirit that makes him mute. And whenever it seizes him, it throws him down. He foams and he grinds his teeth and it becomes rigid. He says, so I asked your disciples to cast it out, but they couldn't do it. And he answered them, verse 19, and says, O faithless generation. He says, how long will I be with you? How long am I to put up with you? Bring the boy to me. And they brought the boy to Jesus. And when the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell on the ground, and he rolled around foaming at the mouth. And Jesus asked his father, well, how long has this been happening to him? And he said, from childhood. He said, and it's often cast him into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have mercy on us and help us. Somebody ought to lift their hand and shout, Lord, have mercy. And Jesus said to him, if you can believe, crowd should have gone wild. He says, all things are possible to them that believe. Immediately, the father of the child cried out and said, well, Lord, I believe, but I need you to help me with my unbelief. And Jesus saw the crowd. He saw the crowd came running together, and he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to him, you mute, you deaf and dumb spirit, I command you to come out of him and never enter him again. And after crying out with a loud voice and convulsing him terribly, the spirit came out. And the boy was like a corpse, insomuch that most of them said, he is dead. But Jesus, y'all ain't happy yet, took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when they entered the house, the disciples asked him privately, well, why couldn't we cast it out? And he said to them that this kind can only come out by fasting and praying. Amen. You can take your seat, but look at verse 26. It says that after crying out, it says that the spirit came out and the boy looked like he was dead, so much so that the people said, he is dead. Here's what I want to talk about today. Don't count me out just yet. Hallelujah. Will you look at somebody on the left and on the right and tell them, whatever you do, don't count me out just yet. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. This pericope is exciting, particularly to those who are in the room who understand what it's like, what it means to be a part of the underprivileged, the disenfranchised, and the disadvantaged. You know, hallelujah, that life can be challenging and can be extremely difficult, particularly when you do not have the support systems that you need in order to do well. Somebody in the room knows what I'm talking about, because your reality is like mine. That is, that you were not born with a silver spoon in your mouth. You were not born to millionaire, billionaire parents. You didn't grow up on the right side of the tracks. In fact, you perhaps, amen, came from the side of the tracks where they said nothing good can come from that side of the tracks. So somebody knows what I'm talking about, because some of the advantages that were afforded perhaps to some people in your concentric circle of contact, you were not able to have those same kinds of advantages and privileges. And so your testimony is this, that if it had not been for the Lord on your side, you don't even know, hallelujah, that you would still be alive today. Somebody in here, hallelujah, can identify with this, because your existential plight, your personal predicament, your circumstance right now suggests that you will not, perhaps you will not, you cannot, you will not make it from where you are to where God really wants you to be. I came, hallelujah, on my way back to Atlanta to let you know that in spite of what the people suggest, and in spite of what some of your fake phony friends suggest, and in spite of what the statistics suggest, and in spite of what the sociologist says and the psychologist says, I came to tell somebody on your row, if not you, that they should never count you out, because the good news is, hallelujah, that God has the last word over your life. Is there anybody here who's glad about the fact that God has the last word over your life? Because if your family members would have had their way, your fake phony friends would have had their way, your reality is that you wouldn't even be up in church today. But look at you now. Against all of the odds and against all of the disadvantages, you are up in church today looking good with your glad rags on. And that's because nobody happy but you, me and you, bruh. God has the last word over your life. Is there anybody besides me who's hallelujah happy? I got one, I got two, I got three, I got four. About the fact that God has the last word over your life. And so do me one favor real quick and just look at somebody on the left-hand side and tell them things are not what I want them to be. My situation may not be all that I want it to be, but whatever you do, don't count me out just yet, because it ain't over until God says it's over. The text is exciting, because here in this passage of scripture we meet Jesus as he's coming off the mountain of transfiguration. He's coming off the mountain of transfiguration along with Peter, James, and John. And you know what happened? Church got so good up on the mountain of transfiguration until Peter speaks up and says, good googa mooga, it's good for us to be here. We ought to just stay up here on the mountain, and we ought to build three tabernacles. tabernacles, Jesus, because we need to stay here and stay in church all the time. But Jesus says we can't stay up on the mountain because there's some work that needs to be done in the valley. I think I need to take a pause for the cause right here, because deliver me from people who always want to stay on the mountain of spiritual ecstasy, always want to be up in church and neglect the fact that there's some work that's got to happen down in the valley. We can't stay in praise all the time. We can't stay in worship all the time, because there's a daughter in the valley that needs to be delivered. There's a son in the valley that needs to be set free. There's a crack addict in the valley that needs to come to Christ. There's a prostitute in the valley that needs to get to the worship center. There's somebody in the valley who needs to meet Jesus Christ. And so we can't stay up on the mountain because there's work to be done down in the valley. And so they come off the mountainside, Peter, James, and John, and they meet the other disciples, hallelujah, as they are engaged in an argument with the scribes and the Pharisees. Look at the text, because it says that they are arguing with the scribes and the Pharisees, so much so that Jesus says to his remaining nine disciples, what are you arguing with them about? Why are you in this discussion with them? Why are you arguing with them? I want to suggest to you tonight that they are arguing, hallelujah, about petty points and petty positions, arguing about who's going to get the certificate of appreciation, arguing about who's going to open the door, who's going to lock the door, arguing about who's going to sing the solo, who's going to direct the choir, arguing about things that really don't matter in the kingdom of God and in the church of the living God. If we could ever stop arguing about stuff that really don't matter and really get to doing ministry and about kingdom business, we would save whole neighborhoods. If we could ever stop arguing about whether or not you're baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, or do you do it in the name of Jesus, we'd be able to turn the world upside down. If we could ever stop arguing, should you wear long dresses and white, or should you wear short dresses, or no dress at all, we could do something to build the kingdom of God. But we got to stop arguing about things that do not matter. I wish I had help with this right about now. Will you look at somebody on the right hand side and tell them, I done made up my mind that I ain't got time to argue with you about things that do not matter. That ain't the right neighbor. Find another neighbor. Find a different neighbor and tell them, I ain't got time to argue with you about things that do not matter. So what if you don't speak to me? It don't really matter that much. So what if you don't smile at me? It don't really matter that much. So what if you can't stand me? The truth is, I don't like you too much either. So it really don't matter that much. Will you nudge somebody on the left and tell them, it really doesn't matter that much? Have I got any help in the building? And so Jesus comes off the mountain and says, what are you arguing with them about? It's a Christ. Christ is frustrated at this point. Hallelujah. He's frustrated. He's frustrated. While his disciples, hallelujah, and the church has failed. I said Christ is frustrated and the church has failed. Notice that this concerned father has come to the disciples, the church that remained in the valley, and said to Jesus, I brought my son to your disciples, but they couldn't do anything. I'm trying to tell you that the church has failed. The church has failed. And whenever the church is failing, it frustrates Christ. How do you know? Because Jesus says, oh, faithless generation, how long am I going to have to put up with you? How long am I going to have to suffer with you? And he sounds like a frustrated pastor, because pastors get frustrated whenever you don't get the vision. I
wish I had somebody who would catch it right about now, because he says, how long shall I put up with you? You mean to tell me you've been walking with me this long and you still don't get it yet? You mean to tell me you've been coming to church this long and you still don't get it yet? You mean to tell me you've been teaching Sunday school this long and you still don't get it yet? I told y'all I was grown and ain't scared of none of y'all, but I'm trying to tell you that the Holy Ghost had me come by here today to tell you that it's about time that you start to get it. I wish I had somebody who would catch what I'm saying. Will you look at a neighbor and ask them, when are you going to get it? Preach, Pastor Hamner. I'm doing the best I can. Because by now, you ought to have it. By now, look, you're going to make this longer than it need to be. You ought to know that ministry, hallelujah, and church does not revolve around you. Can we just lift our hands collectively? I got to move off of this and shout, it's not about us, but it's about Jesus. Christ is frustrated. The church has failed. But here comes this concerned father. He says, I brought my son to your disciples, but your disciples couldn't do anything. Hallelujah. Jesus says, well, bring the boy to me. Bring the boy to me. The text says that when they bring the boy to Jesus, that the spirit convulses the boy and hallelujah. Jesus says, well, listen, if you can only believe, all things are possible to them that believe. Can I tell you this? That if you're not going to be counted out, you're going to have to declare your doubt and your disbelief. Because don't you hear the Father saying, Lord, I believe, but what I need you to do is help my unbelief. Here it is. I know this is a little much for some of you spiritual people, but the reality is that no matter how saved you are, doubt will get the best of you sometime. No matter how long you've been in church, sometimes there's something in you that won't let you believe like you know you ought to believe. And that's why you got to have some faith friends. You ought to be able to hook up with some homies that are headed the same way you are headed, and somebody who will believe for you when you can't believe for yourself. He says, Lord, I believe, but I need you to help my unbelief. Because there's something in me that keeps on tugging at me, causing me not to trust God the way I know I need to trust Him. I got to pause for a moment, because the opposite of doubt is not more faith, but the opposite of doubt is more trust. And somebody listening to me right now, you keep telling my Lord, I need you to increase my faith. No, that ain't what you need. What you need to do is raise your trust level. Hallelujah. Yeah. Little rap artist said it like this. He said, turn down for what? Turn down for what? And I think, hallelujah, that we ought to adopt a little bit of that. I wish I had some help from the young squad. Because when doubt is getting the best of you, that's when you got to turn up your faith. You got to turn up your faith. I know you're trying to blame it on the alcohol, but you got to turn up your faith. Because if you turn up your faith, you'll turn up your ability to trust in God. When you look at somebody around you and tell them, turn up, 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 turn up. Turn up your trust level. He said, Lord, I believe, but I need you to help my unbelief. Notice the text, if you please, because Jesus makes this declaration of deliverance. Text says that he looks at that spirit and says to that spirit that's in the boy, shut up and come out of him. Y'all ain't happy here yet. He says, hallelujah, in verse number 25, he says, I command you to come out of the boy. I command you to come out and never enter into him again. And you know what happened, don't you? That spirit came out. I know we're not in a Pentecostal church, but and I was raised in the Baptist church, but in 2016, let me testify, I still know that God can deliver. Oh, I wish I had some help in the building. Hallelujah. Is there anybody here who knows that God still delivers? He delivers from crack. He delivers from alcohol. He delivers from whoremongering. He delivers from lying. He delivers from gossiping. He delivers from drug dealing and drug using. Is there anybody here who can testify that he still delivers? He delivers from the outhouse to the White House, from the back of the house to the front of the house. I wish I had some help over in here who can testify that you're delivered. Praise the Lord. Because when Jesus speaks, he speaks with power. He speaks without any fear of contradiction. He speaks knowing that when he says it, things have got to change. Oh, you're looking funny, but all you need the Lord to do is to speak in the midst of your situation. Because somebody can testify that one word from the Lord will change your situation around. Hallelujah. He speaks and makes the declaration of deliverance. But check it out, because what I need you to see, hallelujah, in verse number 26 is this. I need you to see the destruction that comes prior to deliverance. Because the text says that Jesus spoke in 25 and told the spirit to come out the boy. But when he came out, it says that the boy, hallelujah, convulsed and he hollered with a loud voice. And it looked like the boy was dead, to the point that most people said he is dead. Listen, what I'm trying to tell you is this, that just because the devil is tearing up some things, it doesn't mean that it's a sign that he's taken over. It could be a sign that he got his eviction notice, because he'll always tear up some things when he knows he's got to go. I wish you would watch the word for a minute. He'll tear up your finances because he's got to go. He'll tear up your marriage because he's got to go. He'll tear up your family because he's got to go. And sometimes he'll tear up the church because he's got to go. He'll always tear up some things, but that's not a sign that he's here to stay. It could be a sign that he knows that he's got his eviction notice, and he knows that he's got to go. I wish somebody would lift their hands right about now and shout, hit the road, Jack! And don't you come back no more, no more, no more. Because he'll always tear up some things when he knows that it's time to go. Hallelujah. The other thing I need you to see is in 26b, because I need you to see the diagnosis of the crowd. It says that the crowd said, the boy is dead. It says that the spirit convulsed him, left out of the boy, and the boy looked like he was dead. Ain't nobody happy but me in here. In so much, hallelujah, that the crowd said, he is dead. And somebody in the room this afternoon ought to be glad that the crowd doesn't have the last word over your life. Is there anybody who's on your roll who's hallelujah happy? Because are you glad that the crowd doesn't know what they're talking about? And I need to tell somebody this, hallelujah, that, hallelujah, you need to beware of stupid people. .com, look it up, because they got t-shirts and caps. Hallelujah. Shake somebody's hand on the right hand side and tell them, beware of stupid people. Because stupid people always misdiagnose a situation. Because stupid people will look at a situation and declare that it's over. But somebody in here ought to be glad that it ain't over until God says that it's over. Have I got anybody happy in the room? Is there anybody glad that God has the last word in your life? Will you high five another neighbor and tell that neighbor, it might look like I'm dead, but it ain't over until God says it's over. Have I got anybody happy? Because understand that what was happening, y'all, was the young man was doing the rope-a-dope. Have I got anybody happy? In 1975, there was a thriller in Manila. It was Muhammad Ali against George Foreman. And George Foreman was younger, bigger, and stronger. And Muhammad Ali, y'all, was there ready to fight George Foreman. And Ali, y'all, showed up in Manila. And he was there listening to the people cheering Ali, Ali. Have I got me a witness? But when they got in the ring, Ali, y'all, stood in the ring and got on his bicycle and he danced around for a little while in the ring. But after a while, he leaned back on the ropes in the ring and he let George Foreman throw his best punch. Have I got me a witness here? And Ali, y'all, he did that for about 8 rounds. And he came off of the ropes. And he saw George Foreman walk right up to him, threw his best punch, and knocked Foreman out. Have I got me a witness here? And at the interview, it was Howard Cosell who said, Cassius, what were you doing laying on the ropes? He said, well, Howard, that was my strategy. What I decided was to do what I call the rope-a-dope. Have I got me a witness? And every now and then, that's what you have to do when the devil is working in your life. Get on the ropes. Let the devil throw his best punch. Have I got me a witness? For the young squad, I heard Fat Joe say, lean back, rock from side to side, do the rock away. Have I got me a witness? Slap somebody, a high five in here, and tell them every time I praise the Lord, that's me doing the rope-a-dope. Every time I give him glory, I'm simply doing the rope-a-dope. But give me a little while longer, cause I'm coming off of those ropes, throwing my best punch, and the devil has got to get out of my life. Have I got anybody happy? Somebody here, that's where you are, doing the rope-a-dope. But I'm glad that it might look like I'm dead. you do. Don't count me out. Not yet. Slap your neighbor a high five in here and tell your neighbor, don't count me out, because it ain't over until God says it's over. Shout yeah. Shout yeah. Shout yeah. Shout yeah. I got to get out of here. I ain't worried about none of y'all. I didn't preach myself happy. Didn't mean to act like this. Got to get back across town. Didn't mean to act like this. But if I was in College Park, and when I get this happy, I ask my church, do y'all feel like having church? Do you feel like having church? If you feel like it, shout yeah. Hallelujah. Well, do me a favor. Stand up on your feet. Come off of your row. Go find three people. Throw your arms around them. Tell them. I thought y'all felt like having it. Come off of your row. Go find three people. Throw your arms around them. Tell them. I came over here just to let you know what. Whatever you do, don't count me out. Don't write me off. Don't push me down. Don't throw me away, because it ain't over until God says it's over. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Will he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Will he do it? Will he, won't he? Won't he, will he? Will he, won't he? Won't he, will he? Say yeah! Say yeah! Say yeah! Ah, yeah! Ah, yeah! I know he will. Slap somebody a high five and tell him, I know he will. He's able to keep me from falling. Able to pick me up. Able to send me on my way. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Say yeah. Say yeah. Say yeah. Well, well, y'all are mighty cool for people who know that it ain't over until God says it's over. Shake your neighbor's hand one more time. I'm leaving you alone. And tell him, neighbor, oh neighbor, it ain't over until God says it's over. Don't let him go yet. But tell him, neighbor, you don't have to wait until he picks you up to shout about it. You don't have to wait until your storm is over to praise God for it. You don't have to wait until you get healed to give him praise. Let that hand go and tell your neighbor, I think I will praise him while I'm on my way. Can I get 8 or 9 of y'all to give him praise while you're on your way to rising up again? He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Oh, yeah. don't know why y'all require music. Ain't no music in your car when you near about had a wreck. I say, ain't no music, hallelujah, in that hospital when you're laying on your hospital bed. So you ought to be able to praise him even if you don't have any music. But since we're in church and I left home to do this, I think we ought to take a praise break. Is anybody gonna join me? Don't leave me by myself. I wish I had somebody who would help me over here. Don't leave me by myself. Will you just take a minute and give him praise? Cause you know it ain't over. It ain't over. It ain't over. It ain't over. It ain't over.
Excuse me, Reverend, but it ain't over until God says it's over. The devil might count you out. Family may count you out. Friends may count you out. But I'm so glad, I'm so glad, I'm so glad that God has the last word. God has the last word. You ought to tell the Lord thank you. You ought to tell the Lord thank you. God has the last word. God has the last word. Yeah. Hallelujah. 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 Bless his holy name. Bless his holy name. Bless his holy name. Bless his holy name. Folk thought you were counted out. Doctor said it's over. Somebody, lawyer said you don't have a chance. It ain't over till God says it's over. And until God says it's over, I'm going to run on and see what the end's going to be. I said, I'm going to run on and see what the end's going to be. I'm going to run on and see what the end's going to be. And maybe, just maybe, you need to get another opinion. I said, maybe, just maybe, you need to get another opinion. You've been hearing the opinions of people and haters and folk around you, and they've been telling you it's over and there's nothing that can be done and all that kind of stuff. But Jesus comes, and Jesus has the last word. I said, Jesus has the last word. I said, Jesus has the last word. And you ought to thank God that Jesus has the last word. He has the last word. You remember on the cross when he was dying, hanging and bleeding and dying and blood was coming down, he had the last word. Guess what his last words were? It's finished. It was not a cry of like, oh, it's finished. It was a cry of victory. He says it's finished. But even though it's not in the Bible, I think he said something else. So I think he said it's finished, but I just got started. Price has been paid, but I just got started. He's still working, y'all. The question is, will you trust him? Will you trust him? I'm asking again, will you trust him? Will you really, sure enough, trust him? It looks like it's over. Everybody's acting like it's over. But God is the one. When it's time to be over. And until he says it's over, I'm going to keep plugging. I'm going to keep pushing. I'm going to keep fishing. I'm going to keep working. I'm going to keep getting up in the morning. I'm going to keep on going until the Lord says it's over. Because until he says it's over, it ain't over. It ain't over. It ain't over.
Thank God for the preacher on today. Thank God. Thank God for the preacher. Here's the invitation. Here's the invitation. Here's the invitation. Someone in a position now, and everybody says so, but it looks like it's over. And you need God to help you get beyond where you are. Yeah. Yeah. Here's the problem. When we're going through, we focus on what we're going through. When we're going through, we focus on what we're going through. Someone said it like this. Most of the time, we point to God and say, you see how big this problem is. We need to look at the problem and say, do you know how big my God is? He's able. I said he's able. You keep on reading down that passage, it says, Jesus says now, but there's a certain kind, this kind can't come but through prayer and fasting. And maybe, just maybe, we've been trusting our own self and leaning to our own understanding. Maybe we need to get back to that old stuff. Prayer and fasting, that's not Pentecost, it's not holiness, that's Bible. And maybe we need to push back from the table, food, and push towards the word of God and prayer, so that when this kind come, it won't be no problem. Somebody help me in this place. We're going to ask you to bow your head just for a second. I'm going to ask a couple questions. Number one, if you're here and you've never received the Lord by faith, that's number one. You never said yes to him. You need to get that straight right now. And if that speaks of you, I need you to lift your hands. I want to get saved on today. I want to get saved on today. I want to receive salvation. Number two then. You see, I'm here. I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. I don't have a church home, and I need one. Pray for me. If that speaks of you, I want you to raise your hand quickly. Need a church home, don't have one, I need you to pray for me. All right, last one. I'm in a spot, and a lot of times the spots we in, they just happen, life happens. Sometimes spots happen because of our own ignorance, our own stupidity, of our own doing. So wherever you got in the spot, that's how you get. You're there now. And you said, Lord, I've counted it out and others are counting it out, but Lord, help me trust you. Because if you say it's not over, I'm going to continue to trust you. If you're someone and you say, I'm down for the count, but I need Lord, to help me trust you. I think that was a Sunday school lesson this morning. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. And if you need God to help you, I just want you to stand to your feet and we're going to pray. I'm standing. Life is such a trip sometimes. You're like, Lord, what in the world is going on? Why is this happening? God says, I want you to trust me. I'm glad Dr. Hamner brought that out about faith, because we say we have faith. Faith is not just something you have. Faith is something that you do. So, Lord, as we come now, we're thanking you for your word. Thank you for the preacher. Thank you, Lord, for
us to see that there are times when things get beyond our control. And even then, God, help us to not listen to uninformed people. They don't know my situation. They looking in on the outside and they're making judgments. Help me not to listen to that. Help me, Lord, to direct me to some people who are going to give me truth. And give me truth even when it hurts. Help me, Lord, to get that right opinion. And then, Lord, help me to look unto you. Because really all my help comes from you. And so, Lord, as I'm going through what I'm going through, sometimes I got to use, as Pastor said, the rope-a-dope, lean on the ropes and let the devil take his shots. And while the devil is shooting, all I'm doing is resting and worshiping and getting ready to stand on your word. So, God, we ask that you would help us today. Some are tomorrow going to have to tackle some stuff and deal with some stuff, God, that we don't know about. You know about it. I'm praying that you would give us strength. I'm praying that you would give us strength. I'm praying that you'll give us strength, God. And then help us to remember that, he's about to be evicted. Thank you, God. So we're going to thank you in advance for victory. We're going to thank you in advance for victory. We're going to thank you in advance for victory. In Jesus' name. And if you love the Lord, say hallelujah,
hallelujah.
And amen. Let's give God a big hand of praise right now. Hallelujah. Bless God. Bless God on today. Amen. Excuse me, I need to do this real quick. I got a call on yesterday. And whatever. Rihanna and Glenn, can you guys come on up, please? Is there anybody in here that believe that God will hear and answer prayer? I mean, no joke stuff. I mean, for real. Come on and stand right up here, right here. Y'all can face this way. You ain't got to look at everybody. You can face this way. Y'all face this way. I want to encourage you all to do a couple of things. Trust God. I want to encourage you all so maybe get another opinion. Doctors can give reports and say this has got to be this. And it's interesting that We just asked God's blessing upon the baby a few weeks ago. And then the doctor would give that kind of report. I ain't hating on the doctor. I kind of sensed when I heard the news, I'm like, Lord, is this just physical or is it also spiritual? And is it a test to say, God, they need to really grow to trusting you? I don't know. I do know that sometimes Satan calls us stuff and tries to do stuff. Sometimes life happens. Sometimes God allows things to happen. But I'm believing God. I'm believing God for her. I'm believing God has great testimony and great things in store. I'm believing that. I don't know what's going to happen. I'm not going to sit up here and all that stuff, but I'm going to believe God that he can do it without the doctors. He can do it with the doctors, but I know he can do it. And so it's now I'm going to trust him. I'm going to ask those of you who will just kind of stretch your hands up this way in agreement. Amen. God, we thank you. bless you. Jan, come here. Andrew, come here. I want you to stand on this side. Andrew, stand on that side. That side, there you go. And while I'm praying, I want you to take your right hand and just kind of lay it on her back, okay? Lay it on the baby's back. Just put your hand on the back. That's all, okay? Wait a minute. Do you believe that the Lord can heal? You do? Okay, that's all. Come on, y'all. Y'all agree with me. God, we are thankful to you. We are thankful to you. God, we're thankful to you. We're thankful to you. We thank you for the gift of this baby. God, we thank you for the husband, the dad, and the mom. We thank you for them and their dedication to themselves, to you, and to their child. God, we know doctors give reports, but God, we know that you have another report. I read in your word where you said that you were wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was upon you, and with your stripes we are healed. So God, we're praying now your power on our sweetheart, Lord. We ask that you would touch her now. We ask that you would heal her now. God, we're believing that you will. Satan, if you have anything to do with this, the Lord rebuke you now. I said, Satan, if you have anything to do with this, the Lord rebukes you now. We thank God that we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. And so, Satan, this is God. She's God's property. She's God's property. God, we are believing that you're going to heal. We're believing that you're going to heal. We're believing that you're going to heal in Jesus' name. And so, God, we're thanking you in advance. We're thanking you in advance. God, we're thanking you in advance. We are thanking you in advance, God. We are thanking you in advance. In Jesus' name we do pray. Everybody give God a big hand of praise right now. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. He's able. God is able and he won't fail. God is able and he won't fail. God is able. Hey there, sweetie. God is able and he won't fail. Say God is able and he won't fail. God is able and he won't fail. And I'm believing God for a testimony in the next couple of weeks. I'm believing him for that. 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 I'm not saying don't take baby to the doctor. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that God can work through them and God can work without them. In Jesus' name. Come on, y'all, give God a hand of praise. You can go back to your seat now. Hallelujah. Well, guess what time it is now? It's time to return the Lord's tithe and offering. Come on, y'all. Let's move quickly. Amen. Brother Pierce, can you go back there and turn the air on a little bit? Amen. Now hold up, y'all. I need to let you know something. When it's like this, anybody who, if you work out in the gym or if you are an athlete or something like that, when you're working out, you can't have the cold air on you because it can cause you to get sick. And especially for a preacher, listen, all that I have is my throat. And that cold air, it takes it away, and I got to take care of it. And he's got a couple other assignments to preach, and we wanted to make sure that he was cool. So when it's like that, y'all kind of bear with us because we're just trying to, you know, do what we can to take care of. Amen. But we want to try to make you as comfortable as we can, and at the same time, take care of the preacher. So again, God bless you. Thank you, Brother Pierce. It's time to return the Lord's tithe and offering. We're going to ask that those who will be coming to get in order. Amen. Pray for Reverend Wyatt. He's gone over to East Campus to preach to East Campus on the day, and he had to go teach Sunday school as well. So we want to pray for him. We're going to ask the ushers to come, and they're going to give envelopes to those who need them, including me, Matthew. Thank you, Dad. Thank you.
It's time to return the Lord's tithe and offering. The Word of God shares with us that it becomes our responsibility to bring all the tithe into the storehouse. And when we do, well, first of all, we're being obedient to the Word of God. And then God says that I will open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. And I don't know about you, but I need some open door blessings, some open window blessings. I sure do. And God promises that he'll do just that when we return the Lord's tithe. The Bible also says, given it shall be given unto you good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. For the same measure you meet when you give it shall be given back to you. It becomes our responsibility to say, Lord, I love you, and I appreciate you this much, and I'm going to give an offering. Some of you may say that I've already shared tithe and offering. I already shared the tithe for the month. You know, some people get paid every month, once a month. They've already done that. But God has blessed you with some extra. So, you know what, I want to go ahead and just tell God to thank you by giving an offering. That offering is based upon how much you have. You can't give what you don't have. But if God has blessed you, we pray that you would honor him in giving an offering as well. Is everyone ready to give? Let's lift our gifts to the Lord now. God, because of your goodness and mercy towards us, we offer you thanksgiving. You've been good. You've blessed us. You've kept us. You've watched over us. You've provided for us. You've protected us, God. And then we thank you for allowing us to come back to the house of prayer that we can be blessed through your word. We come now to give back to you a portion of what you bless us with through tithe and offering. God, we pray your blessings upon the gifts and the givers. God, we thank you and we bless you for your provision. Bless now. In Jesus' name we do pray. And everyone said, thank God. And amen. 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 Is Brother Smothers over there? You ready? Did we get it? We getting it or we got it? We getting it? We got it. Oh, thank you, Lord. All right, brothers and mothers, you ready? Okay, all right. Those who are going to give by credit card or debit card, we ask that you please go in the overflow area, and the rest of us will be under the direction of the ushers. Cameron, can you play some music back there? You don't have it? Okay, we'll figure something out. Don't worry about it. We're gonna sing old school style.